It's fur trade. ASMR. Today, we're gonna be doing our second episode of Reading a New Earth by Eckhart, Tolle. Excited to be doing this one again. We got our comfy clothes on. Sipping on that as we read. Anyway, without further ado, let's jump into it. So, here we go. Sort of the heading for this next little anecdote is called The Lost Ring. Seeing people as a counselor and spiritual teacher, I would visit a woman twice a week whose body was riddled with cancer. She was a school teacher in her mid-40s and had been given no more than a few months to live by her doctors. Sometimes a few words were spoken during those visits, but mostly we would sit together in silence. And as we did, she had her first glimpses of the stillness within herself that she never knew existed and during her busy that she never knew existed during her busy life as a school teacher. One day, however, I arrived to find her in a state of great distress and anger. "What happened?" I asked. "Her diamond ring, of great monetary as well as sentimental value, disappeared, and she said she was sure it had been stolen by the woman who came to look for her for a few hours every day. She said she didn't know how anybody could be so callous and heartless as to do this to her. She asked me whether she should confront the woman or whether it would be better to call the police immediately. I said I could tell her what to do, but asked her to find out how important a ring or anything else was at this point in her life. "You don't understand," she said. "This is my grandmother's ring. I used to wear it every day until I got ill and my hands became too swollen. It's more than just a ring to me. How can I not be upset?" Of her response and anger and defensiveness in her voice were indications that she had not yet become present enough to look within and to detangle her reaction from the event and observe them both. Her anger and defensiveness were signs that the ego was still speaking through her. I said, "I'm going to ask you a few questions, but instead of answering them now, see if you can find the answers within you. I will pause briefly after each question. When an answer comes, it may not necessarily come from the words." She said she was ready to listen. I asked, "Do you realize that you will have to let go of the ring at some point, perhaps quite soon?" "How much more time do you need before you will be ready to let go of it? Will you become less when you let go of it? Has who you are become diminished by the loss?" There were a few minutes of silence after the last question. When she started speaking again, there was a smile on her face, and she seemed at peace. The last question made me realize something important. First, I went to my mind for an answer, and my mind said, "Yes, course you haven't been diminished. Then I ask myself the question again. Has who I am become diminished? This time I tried to feel rather than look for the answer. And suddenly I could feel my amness. I have never felt that before. If I can feel I am so strongly, then who I am hasn't been diminished at all. I can still feel it now. Something peaceful, but very, very alive. That is the joy of being, I said. You can only feel it when you get out of your head. Being must be felt. It can't be thought. The ego doesn't know about it because never really attached to a thing, but to a thought that has I, me, or mine in it. Whenever you completely accept a loss, you go beyond ego and who you are, the I am, which is in consciousness itself, emerges. She said, now I understand something Jesus said that never made sense to me before. If someone takes your shirt, let him have your coat as well. That's right, I said. It doesn't mean you should never lock your door. All it means is that sometimes letting things go is an act of far greater power than defending or hanging. Last few weeks of her life, as her body became weaker, she became more and more radiant, as if light were shining through her. She gave many of her possessions away, and to the woman she thought had stolen the ring. And with each thing she gave away, her joy deepened. When her mother called me to let me know she had passed away, she also mentioned that after her death, they found her ring in the medicine cabinet of the bathroom. Did the woman return the ring, or had it been there all the time? Nobody will ever know. One thing we do know, life will give you whatever experience is most helpful to the evolution of your consciousness. How do you know? I'm yawning a bit. How do you know that this is the experience you need? Because this is the experience you are having at the moment. Actually kind of relates to at the end of last video about like losing your bracelet, but in this case it's a ring. Here's a good point. Is it wrong then to be proud of one's possessions or to feel resentful towards people who have more than you? Not at all. That sense of pride, of needing to stand out, the apparent enhancement of oneself through more than, and diminishment through less than, is neither right nor wrong. It is the ego. The ego isn't wrong, it's just unconscious. When you observe the ego in yourself, you are beginning to go beyond it. Don't take the ego too seriously. When you detect egoic behavior in yourself, smile. At times you may even laugh. How could humanity be taken in this far for so long? Above all, know that ego isn't personal. It is who you are. Excuse me, it isn't who you are. Ego is not personal. If you consider the ego to be your personal problem, that's just more ego. I get that. So, like they said, like, you know, I have a hard time, like, I'm dealing with ego right now. You know, ego's really giving me, like, something to work on. As if, I don't know, like, everyone has, like, some people just don't notice it, right? It's not your own personal problem. Like, that's just ego telling you, like, oh, you're someone who has ego as a problem. It's kind of weird to think about, but I think it's true. Ego is definitely tricky. The part about smiling at it, actually experience that quite a bit. It's mostly, I mean, it's definitely harder to do it when you're in the moment, when you're speaking. Like, sometimes you don't notice until, like, maybe a minute later when your mind is thinking back on the conversation you just had, and you're like, oh, damn. Yeah, that was the ego coming up. But, I mean, noticing it is fine. But a lot of the times when I'm just, like, thinking, like, I'm not speaking, right? Like, I'm in the grocery store and I see, like, I don't know, or let's say, like, a guy in, like, a nice motorcycle goes by and it's really loud, and my ego's instantly thinking, like, look at this dude, he thinks he's so cool. Like, I smile to myself, I'm like, yep, there goes ego again. A similar note, it'd be like, there's this, this guy, he's like asleep, right? He has no idea that there's more than just, you know, material values, lot more. He's like, oh, there's more to life than that. Oh, that's a spiritual ego saying, I'm more spiritual than this guy, you know? And then you'll smile at yourself, you know, you'll just shake your head, and you'll be like, you know? So it should be something you beat yourself up over. Anyway, let me take a sip of my coffee. Sorry, I'm yawning here a lot. I don't know. something, what does it really mean? What does it mean to make something mine? If you stand on a street in New York, point to a huge skyscraper and say, that building is mine, I own it, you are either very wealthy, or you are delusional, or a liar. In any case, you are telling a story in which the thought form I and the thought form building merge into one. That's how the mental concept of ownership works. If everybody agrees with your story, there will be signed pieces of paper to certify their agreement with it. You are wealthy. If nobody agrees with the story, they will send you to a psychiatrist. You are delusional or a compulsive liar. It is important to recognize here that the story and the thought forms that make up the story, whether people agree with you or not, absolutely nothing to do with who you are. Even if people agree with it, it is ultimately a fiction. I'm gonna open the curtains here, sorry. Many people don't realize until they're on their deathbed, and eventually external falls away, that no thing ever had anything to do with who they are. In the proximity of death, the whole concept of ownership stands revealed and ultimately meaningless in the last moments of their life. They also realize that while they were looking throughout their lives for a more complete sense of self, what they were really looking for, their being, had actually always been there, but had largely been obscured by their identification with things, which ultimately means identification with their mind. Blessed are the poor in spirit, Jesus said, for theirs be the kingdom of heaven. What does poor in spirit mean? No inner baggage, no identifications, not with things, nor with any mental concepts that have a sense of self in them. And what is the kingdom of heaven? The simple, profound joy of being is that when you let go of identification, so become poor in spirit. This is why renouncing all possessions has been an ancient spiritual practice in both East and West. Renunciation of possessions, however, will not automatically free you of the ego. It will attempt to ensure its survival by finding something else to identify with. For example, a mental image of yourself as someone who has transcended all interest in material possessions and is therefore superior. Or someone who is more spiritual than others. There are people who have renounced all possessions but have a bigger ego than some millionaires. If you take away one kind of identification, the ego will quickly find another. The ego ultimately doesn't mind what it identifies with, as long as it has an identity. Anti-consumerism or anti-private ownership would be another thought form, another mental position that can replace identification with possessions. right and others wrong is one of the principal egoic mind patterns, one of the main forms of unconsciousness. In other words, the content of the ego may change. The mind structure that keeps it alive does not. I just want to make a note here. Something that I want to add about relinquishing all possessions is, I think, having possessions, it's not bad, but it's kind of like serves as a distraction from, uncovering ego and having consciousness. That being said, I have possessions that I value, and I definitely wouldn't want to get rid of, comforts and stuff like that, and even stuff that aren't comforts that are just, art or something on my wall or on my shelf that I'm that's mine, I like to look at it. But yes, I do agree that it's kind of like a distraction. It's not a bad thing. And if you can sort of get by those distractions, I mean, that's fine as well. Because I guess, let's say you live in a small apartment and you've got just the basics, right? Maybe you got a computer and that's it. So you can watch some stuff, read some books. You maybe find yourself sitting in stillness a lot more when you're not on the computer. Maybe you're just you can breathe in and you're not lost in an art piece on the wall, or lost at looking at your video game or DVD collection. Was a good one I watched. Maybe I should watch that eventually one day. Or you're looking at your library on the wall and being that was a good book. Maybe I'll read that book this afternoon. You're sort of lost in thought. You can be like I said, have less distractions. You can just be and just feel. Maybe you get outside more and you just observe. Whereas you can 100% still do that with, living in an apartment where you own a bunch of stuff, you have a bunch of art, you have knickknacks, you have your clothes, and you set out whichever different pair of clothes that you want, and you're tomorrow I want to wear this, So you can definitely still, breathe and take it all in, but you make it distracting. One of the unconscious assumptions is that by identifying with an object through the fiction of ownership, the apparent solidity and permanency of that material object will endow your sense of self with a greater solidity and permanency. This applies particularly to buildings, and even more so to land, since it is the only thing you think you can own that cannot be destroyed. The absurdity days of the white settlement, the natives of North America found ownership of land an incomprehensible concept, and so they lost it when the Europeans made them sign pieces of paper that were equally incomprehensible to them. They felt like they belonged to the land. But the land did not belong to them. The ego tends to equate having with being. I have, therefore I am. And the more I have, the more I am. Seen by others turns in how you are seen by others turns into how you are seeing how you see yourself. That's very true. If everyone lived in a mansion where everyone was wealthy, your mansion, your wealth would no longer serve to enhance your sense of self. You could then move to a simple cabin, give up your wealth, and regain an identity by seeing yourself and being seen as more spiritual than others. How you are seen by others becomes the mirror that tells you what you are like and who you are. The ego sense of self worth is in most cases bound up with the worth you have in the eyes of others. You need others to give you a sense of self, and if you live in a culture that to a large extent equates self-worth with how much you have, if you cannot look through this collective delusion, you will be condemned to chasing after things for the rest of your life in the vain of finding your worth and completion of your sense of self there. That was a long sentence. Let me see if I can recap in here. So you need others to give you the sense of self. And if you live in a culture equates self-worth to how much you have, and if you cannot see past this collective delusion, then you will be condemned to chasing after things in the hope of finding your worth and completing your sense of self. I sort of paraphrase there. Talking about the, you know, how others see you. Often, I'm not sure if you guys ever had this, but you kind of wanna, you don't wanna be that like weird guy, right? You wanna be sort of, you know, cool. Like, let me wear my nice clothes. Like I'm a cool dude. I'm a normal dude. Like when you're out in public, you know. I feel like that applies even more so, like, when you're alone, because when you're in a group, you don't think about it, you're like, like, I have friends, like, nobody can judge me, like, I don't care, I'm chilling with my friends, but try being alone and thinking the same way, your mind definitely goes in circles, my mind too. For the longest time, I'd be like, oh, I have friends, like, they don't know that I have friends, but, like, I have friends, and, like, I'm pretty cool, like, I have a lot of friends, like, I'm just choosing to be, like, alone right now. That was a common thought from my mind, but, I feel like I've managed to break down that thought a lot, and, you know, I'm fine being alone, like, I don't mind being the, like, my mind might say sometimes, oh, they might think you're you're a weirdo. Or, well, they probably think you're a loner. But, like, that doesn't bother me anymore. Because I'm like, I don't know, I guess I feel pretty secure. However, the other day I was like, it was weird. I was ordering food. Or waiting for food, actually. And, a group of, I think it was two or three young girls, they came in. And they're sort of, like, talking amongst themselves and, like, giggling. And I couldn't really understand what they were saying. And, like, I was on my phone. And, I was playing, like, a little phone game while I waited. And my mind instantly was like, oh, they're probably laughing about you. And I was like, I don't know, I was like, oh, I don't care. Like, they're just young, you know, they're not spiritual, they don't understand yet. They don't understand there's more to life than just, you know, being cool. Like, I bet you if they talked to me, they'd know how chill I was. And it was kind of odd that, like, for a moment, like, it kind of bothered me. And it took me a few moments to kind of be like, huh? Like, I had kind of gotten over, like, the silent sort of, like, you know, you walk somewhere and people look at you and say, oh, this dude's walking alone. Like, that didn't bother me, but as soon as, you know, I went a step further to someone who maybe had less filter, and look, chances are they were probably laughing at some inside joke. Like, I definitely know that, but regardless, that sort of triggered me when it was more something more, like, vocal. You know, my mind, or my ego got the better of me then. Anyway, that was just a little thing I wanted to share. But, I mean, like, I think that was definitely good. That's it, you know, it made me realize. Let's continue. Upset, anxious, or so on, it means you are attached. If you are aware that you are identified with the thing, the identification is no longer total. I am the awareness that is aware that there is attachment. That's the beginning of transformation of consciousness. See, I have a lot of that. So, I mean, if you do too, that's great. Like, my cell phone, I got a new cell phone recently, and I really love it. And, yeah, like, it allows me to do some videos with it. I play some phone games on it. Like, I take pictures. I, like, customize, like, the backgrounds. And I think, like, I'm sort of scared to lose it. And, yeah, like, it would suck if I lost it. I'd be angry. I could definitely, like, you know, I could afford a new one, let's say. Like, I wouldn't be bankrupt on the street, right? But I don't want to lose it. So I recognize my attachment. To my phone. But I guess that's good because I'm aware. I'm sure that just if you're not attached to something doesn't mean you're not careful about it either, right? So I mean, I guess it takes loss to really reveal if you truly are attached to something or not. I was actually thinking the other day, I think a good exercise for attachment is kind of like doing like a cleanup of your stuff, right? Because I feel like if you're a hoarder, or even like on a small scale, right? Like I bought a new hairbrush, and like my old hairbrush was used. I don't know. I'm thinking of the French word here. But like, I was fine only having one hairbrush, but now that I bought a new one, I was like, I mean, oh, like, I can still keep the second one. It could go maybe, like, if I'm traveling somewhere, I can have one to travel there, and I can leave one at home. But it sort of started revealing my attachment to the item. Like, do I really need two hairbrushes? So what I ended up doing is, and still I was aware of my attachment, I put it in a drawer, and I was like, I don't know, if 2 weeks, if a month goes by, and you're thinking, a month, but I mean, at the same time, like, this is what I guess what I need to realize it. If a month goes by, and I don't take that airbrush out of that drawer, and use it, well then I'll throw it out, you know? So yeah, if you're doing like a little cleanup, like let's say you have a lot of pair of pants, you know, sometimes and there's some that you don't wear, like do a cleanup, donate some of those pair of pants away. Same applies, you know, like shirts or socks or something. Sometimes that's really good. If you know, you buy something new, should donate something else within reason, right? Like I recently bought like a new hoodie, and I love my new hoodie, but I could probably do to give away one of the hoodies I don't wear often. And I think that could be a good exercise in being aware of your attachments to stuff. Again, you don't have to give it away, but I think giving away is sort of a way to relinquish that attachment. I know in the past I've done that, especially when I was moving. I didn't want to have to move a bunch of stuff that I didn't need. And I have to say, I don't miss any of the things that I donated or I threw away. I don't miss any of them. It's an interesting, I think, way to look at it. Let me just reposition myself, sitting down here, take a little sip. Identifies with having, but its satisfaction in having is a relatively shallow and short-lived one. Concealed within it remains a deep-seated sense of dissatisfaction, of incompleteness, of not enough. I don't have enough yet, by which the ego really means I am not enough yet. As we have seen, having, concept of all. itself stand out, make itself special. Since you cannot find yourself through having. However, there is another more powerful drive underneath it that pertains to the structure of ego, the need for more, which we could also call wanting. No ego can last for long without the need for more. Therefore, wanting keeps the ego alive much more than having. Wants to want more than it wants to have. The ego wants to want more than it wants to have. And so, shallow satisfaction of having is always replaced by more wanting. This is the psychological need for more. That is to say, more things to identify with. It is an additive need, not an authentic. Sorry, it is an addictive need, not an authentic one. I guess that means like an authentic need would be like, you know, food, safety, shelter. Or an addictive need is like, you know, yeah, not necessary, not authentic. In some cases, the psychological need for more, or the feeling of not enough that is so characteristic of the ego becomes transferred to the physical level and so turns into insatiable hunger. The sufferers of bulimia will often make themselves vomit so that they continue eating. Their mind is hungry, not their body. This eating disorder would become healed if the sufferers, instead of being identified with their mind, could get in touch with their body and so feel the true needs of their body rather than the pseudo needs of an egoic mind. I think this is a very blunt way of putting it, and I sort of read about this more in The Power of Now, but they mentioned, like, this is sort of, I guess it's an insensitive way of putting it, right? If any of you actually suffer from something like bulimia, you're like, how could you be this insensitive? But I guess to be blunt as well, like, having that strong opinion about this is essentially your mind clinging on to that identity that I am bulimic. Like, nobody's saying that you're not bulimic or that it's not a harmful condition. It's them just sort of saying, I guess, like, the root of the issue, and isn't that, like, what we say, it's like a disorder, right? It's not something wrong with the body. I think correct me if I'm wrong, I think we do consider it like a disorder. There's something wrong with the mind, you know. It's not like cancer or something that's like something physically wrong with the body. Your body's reacting in some way. It's, you know, it's very real, but it's in the mind. So that's, I think, I just want to make a quick note of that. If you may have thought that, oh, you know, Eckhart's being really insensitive here, saying, oh, if the person could just get in touch with the body. But I mean, I don't think he's saying it in a sensitive way. He's just being very blunt, very factual. And he's not saying it's easy or hard. He's just saying that's a way. And I guess what I'm saying is being sort of very present. Let's say you have bulimia and you're very present. You can maybe recognize that and be like, oh, that makes sense, I get it. I'm not cured, but I understand. And you're not gonna be like, you know, triggered. Whereas perhaps if you're not conscious enough yet, you might be like angry. You can be like, okay, I understand that, but why are you insensitive? Like, what the heck's wrong with you? You know, you get triggered. And yeah, I guess that's what I sort of wanted to say. But it's not passing any judgment. So let me continue. So he was talking about people slave to them. Some egos know what they want and pursue their aim with grim, ruthless determination. Genghis Khan, Stalin, Hitler. To give just a few larger-than-life examples, the energy behind their wanting, however, creates an opposing energy of equal intensity that in the end leads to their downfall. In the meantime, they make themselves and many others unhappy, or in the larger-than-life examples, create hell on earth. Most egos have conflicting wants. They want different things at different times, or may not even know what they want, except that they don't want what is the present moment. Unease, restlessness, boredom, anxiety, dissatisfaction, are the result of unfulfilled wanting. Wanting is structural, so no amount of content can provide lasting fulfillment as long as the mental structure remains in place. Intense wanting that has no specific object can be often found in the still developing ego of teenagers. For some of whom are in a permanent state of negativity and dissatisfaction. That is like a, you know, a mind-blowing or like mind-opening sentence for me. I never thought of that. When I was a teenager, it's sort of like I grew up in the, I guess, the 90s. My mindset was very emo, I guess you could say. No, I didn't have the style and all that, but, you know, I was very angsty, you know. No one understands me, like, what's the point? All these people, you know, they have all these big goals and stuff. Like, what's the point? Like, oh, this person has a goal. He wants to grow up and have a white picket fence, you know, and a nice house. Like, he understands nothing, you know. And I think that sort of explains it perfectly. Like, my ego is still developing. I was negative. I was dissatisfied. I didn't know what the heck I want. Like, I would play video games and be distracted for a while, or I would, like, you know, get a new toy or something, or listen to, like, a new album, but then, like, late at night, or, you know, when I'm by myself outside, I'd just be, you know, thinking in my mind, and, you know, and then I think what, my ego probably then picked up on was the want of a partner. Like, I was like, oh, I want a girlfriend. I think that was in high school. I was sort of focused on that. Now, well, not 100%. I was still, like, you know, a bit negative and stuff like that. But I think it started to cling to that, oh, I'll be complete when I have this. That's really, really interesting. shelter, clothing, and basic comforts could be easily met for all humans on the planet. Were it not for the imbalance of resources created by the insane and rapacious need for more, the greed of the ego, it finds collective expression in the economic structures of the world, such as huge corporations, which are egoic entities that compete with each other for more. Their only blind aim is profit. They pursue that aim with absolute ruthlessness. Nature, animals, people, even their own employees are no more than digits on a balance sheet, lifeless objects to be used, then discarded. This is another great point, but I think it's like, I want to say a bit deeper, like more encompassing. So like my company, for example, that I work at, they're definitely profit-oriented. All companies are, but I can see it since I work there, like they really value their numbers. And they reward people who bring in more profit, and they sort of overlook like employees, like we're understaffed, and it's really hard sometimes to finish everything we have to do. So they're sort of overlooking, you know, what they could do for us, but at the same time, it's on us as well. Like, I'm pretty happy with what I'm making right now. But some of my colleagues, you know, they want more, they complain, you know, oh, this person makes more, or this company pays more. So at the same time, like we're saying, corporations are greedy, right? They want more. But so do employees. And also, what's the reason why we're missing employees and we can't find any? I think part of the reason is because, you know, employees that want more, they don't want to take a job that maybe pays a bit less than the company I work at. They want, yeah, so they're greedy as well. They're saying, I'm not going to work there. Like, they don't pay enough for me. So that's greed on their level as well. And and the thing is, like, also for the, it goes down to the basic, like having the basic comforts, right? Everybody wants a nicer apartment, a nicer house to live in, which is why they want a job that pays more, right? Because they don't want it, they're greedy, they don't want to downgrade what they live in. And that applies to me as well. Like, I was definitely being greedy when I left my last job and I wanted something more. And I don't regret it at all. I think it was the right decision and it was very good for me. But I think it just applies to everyone, right? And oh yeah, the same thing goes for the ones who own the apartment buildings or the condos, you know, they want more money. They, you know, they don't want to, like, they're not content with, let's say, renovating the building and not upping the rent, you know. They're like, no, if I'm gonna build a nice building, you bet your ass that I'm gonna charge more rent for it. I'm not giving these people a nice place to live, a comfortable place to live for nothing. They're gonna definitely pay for it. So I think it just, everyone is motivated by greed. And unfortunately, sometimes it's so hard because you have to participate in the system. You can't just relinquish everything. place to live, like, so it's really difficult, which is, I think, why what I assume this book is getting at is we need a transformation of humanity as a totality. And I mean, it's very hard to see the, like, to imagine capitalism ending, but I think you don't have to look that far. You gotta sort of just focus on, like, now, you know, focus on doing these exercises, learning, growing, and I think the rest will come naturally. Let's continue here. The thought forms of me and mine, of more than, of I want, I need, I must have, and of not enough pertain not to content, but the structure of the ego. The content is interchangeable as long as you don't recognize those thought forms within yourself. As long as they remain unconscious, you will believe in what they say. Unconscious thoughts, condemned into seeking, not finding, because when those thought forms operate, no procession, place, person, or condition could ever satisfy you. No content will satisfy you as long as the egoic structure remains in place. No matter what you have or get, you won't be happy. You will always be looking for something else that promises greater fulfillment, that promises to make your incomplete sense of self complete and fill that sense of lack you feel within. Satisfied because I don't have enough time. Like, come on. Like, that one in itself is ridiculous. Like, how am I gonna get more time? Excuse me. Alright. Now my ego is telling me that I'm not reading fast enough, but I think chapter 1 is just a really long chapter. Wait, sorry, chapter 2. Let's truly stop on chapter 2, because we've done quite a big chunk of it. Let's go one more. I think this one will be a good... last ending note as an exercise will do. So, identification with the body. Apart from objects, another basic form of identification is with my body. Firstly, the body is male or female, and so the sense of being a man or a woman takes up a significant part of most people's sense of self. Gender becomes an identity. Identification with gender is encouraged at an early age and forces you into a role, into a conditioned patterns of behavior that affect all aspects of your life, not just sexuality. It is a role many people become completely trapped in, even more so in some traditional societies than in Western culture. Western culture where identification with gender is beginning to lessen somewhat. True. In some traditional cultures, the worst fate a woman can have is to be unwed or barren, and for a man to lack sexual potency and not be able to produce children, life's fulfillment is perceived to be the fulfillment of one's gender identity. Because that last little line is very true, or the one before it, about, you know, the lack of, like, a sexual potency, or, like, I guess, like, bearing children being, like, the fulfillment of one's gender identity. That's what I'm getting from this. So, like, you always have that, you know, that voice in your head saying, oh, like, you gotta pass, you gotta have children. Like, children is, it's great to have children. You gotta hurry up. The woman, oh, your clock is ticking. You better hurry up, settle down, have kids before it's too late. That is, like, the ego saying, you're not fulfilled yet. You're not complete yet. You need to have children. I mean, I can relate. I want to have children one day as well. But, like, yeah, that's definitely the ego spouting those views. Take a sip here. It is physical appearance of the body that contributes greatly to a sense of who you think you are. Its strength or weaknesses, its perceived beauty or ugliness relative to others. For many people, their sense of self-worth is intimately bound up with their physical strength, good looks, fitness, and external appearance. Many feel a diminished sense of self-worth because they perceive their body as ugly or imperfect. In some cases, the mental image or concept of my body is a complete distortion of reality. A young woman may... changing the page. A young woman may think of herself as overweight and therefore starve herself. In fact, she is quite thin. She cannot see her body anymore. All she sees is the mental concept of her body, which says, I am fat, or I will become fat. As the root of this condition lies identification with the mind, as many people have become more and more mind-identified, which is the intensification of egoic dysfunction. There has also been a dramatic increase to the incidence of anorexia in recent decades. The sufferer could look at her body without the interfering judgments of her mind. If the sufferer, sorry, could look at her body without the interfering judgments of her mind, or even recognize those judgments for what they are, instead believing for what they are, instead of believing in them. Or better still, if she could feel her body from within, this would initiate her healing. Those who are identified with their good looks, physical strength, or abilities experience suffering when those attributes begin to fade or disappear, as of course they will. Their fiery identity that was based on them is then threatened with the collapse. In either case, ugly or beautiful people derive a significant part of their identity, be it negative or positive, from their body. To be more precise, they derive their identity from the I thought that they erroneously attach to the mental image or concept of their body, which is, after all, no more than a physical form that shares destiny of all forms, impermanence, and ultimately decay, equating the physical sense of perceived is destined to grow old, wither, die, which I always leads to suffering sooner or later. Yeah, so equating. Always gonna lead with suffering, lead to suffering sooner or later. To refrain from identifying with the body doesn't mean that you neglect, despise, or no longer care for it. If it is strong, beautiful, or vigorous, you can enjoy and appreciate those attributes while they last. You can also improve the body's condition through the right nutrition or exercise. If you don't equate the body with who you are, when beauty fades, vigor diminishes, or the body becomes incapacitated, this will not affect your sense of worth or identity in any way. In fact, as the body begins to weaken, the formless dimension, the light of consciousness, can shine through more easily. Just people with a good or near perfect bodies who are likely to equate it with who they are. You can just as easily identify with a problematic body and make the body's imperfections, like illness or disability, into your identity. You may then think or speak of yourself as a sufferer of this chronic illness or disability. You receive a great deal of attention from doctors and others who constantly confirm conceptual identity as the sufferer or as a patient. You then unconsciously cling to the illness because you believe it has become the most important part of who you perceive yourself to be. It has become another thought form which the ego can identify with. Once the ego has found an identity it does not want to let go, amazingly but not infrequently, the ego, in search of a stronger identity, can and does create illness in order to strengthen itself through them. Shifting your attention from the external form of your body and from thoughts about your body, beautiful, ugly, strong, weak, too fat, too thin. You shift it from that to the feeling of aliveness inside. No matter what your body's appearance on the outer level, beyond the outer form is an intensely alive energy field. If you are not familiar with the inner body awareness, close your eyes for a moment and find out if there's still life inside your hands. Don't ask your mind, it will say, "I can't feel anything." Probably it will also say, "Give me something more interesting to think about." So instead of asking your mind, go to your hands directly. If you want, we can do this exercise together. The paragraph isn't too long. I'll read through it, and then we can go through it together. By this I mean, so instead of asking your mind, go to the hands directly. By this I mean become aware of the subtle feeling of aliveness inside them. It is there. You just have to go there with your attention to notice it. You may get a slight tingling sensation at first, sense of aliveness will intensify. Some people won't even have to close their eyes. They will be able to feel their, quotation marks, inner hands at the same time as they read this. Then go to your feet, keep your attention there for a minute or so, and begin to feel your hands and feet at the same time. Then incorporate other parts of your body, legs, arms, abdomen, chest, and so on, into that feeling until you are aware of the inner body as a global sense of your aliveness. What I call the inner body isn't really the body anymore, but life energy, the bridge between form and formlessness. So form being the body, formlessness being like the I am, the spirit, the essence. Make it a habit to feel the inner body as often as you can. After a while, you won't need to close your eyes anymore to feel it. For example, see if you can feel the inner body whenever you listen to someone. It seems almost like a paradox. When you are in touch with the inner body, you are not identified with your body anymore, nor are you identified with your mind. This is to say, you are no longer identified with form, but moving away from form identification to formlessness, which we may also call being. It is your essence identity. Body awareness not only anchors you in the present moment, it is a doorway out of the prison of the that is ego. Also strengthens the immune system and the body's ability to heal itself. Let me put in my bookmark here. So, let's do this exercise together. So, let's sit back. Sit with our like palms facing up. Let's close our eyes and really let's just focus on the palms, the hands. Sorry, for like a minute. Make sure the hands aren't touching each other, and do your best to like, because the mind is for sure gonna be talking. It's gonna be saying, you know, hurry up already. Ignore that. Just try to dive into the hands, like really, really feel them, focus on the feeling, like, you know, when you touch something, you know, you feel if it's rough or smooth, right? Try to focus on that, even though they're not touching anything. So let's start now. No matter what you're feeling, it is it. and just like zoom on that feeling as if you're concentrating on it. I mean, if you're still doing it, try to arm the feet. If not, as soon as we're going to start again, and as soon as you feel it, start feeling in the hands, like shift your focus to your feet. And I mean, you don't got to do anything, just be still and do the same thing. So let's go. past, you were feeling your essence. You know, I don't know about you, but I forgot I wasn't even thinking where I was. I was just focused on the feeling of my body. And now that I'm here, everything seems so still, and I can recognize that it's not me. So, I've done that before. Again, I'm no master. Sometimes I still have to close my eyes. Sometimes I'll do that if I'm getting worked up about a situation. If I can remember, I'll just, you know, go somewhere alone and just like close my eyes and just sort of try to feel the body. I think it's a great exercise. I guess this week for your homework, what I want you to do is, we're gonna do this like as we go to bed. So when you're in bed and you lie down and you're ready for sleep there, like you're actually ready for sleep, you're no longer on your phone, you're kind of like, okay, I gotta sleep now. Instead of letting the mind turn in circles like, oh, I only have 5 hours left before work tomorrow. Oh, I gotta do this. Oh, geez, it's late. Oh, what am I gonna have for breakfast tomorrow? Don't cut off that mind thinking and do this exercise. Lying in your bed, just focus on one body part at a time. I find it's actually a good way to fall asleep. It helps to fall asleep a lot quicker. So not only is there that, but I don't know, it's just sort of an amazing feeling to get in touch with. By all means, feel free to do this through any part of your day, but try to do that, you know, every once in a while. Or I mean, you can do it every night if you want. I don't want to make this seem overwhelming, but as long as you're in bed ready to sleep anyway, there's no harm, right? So thanks so much for listening, and we're still not through chapter 2. We're getting close, but I'll see you guys next time. Thanks for watching.